Good afternoon, everyone. It's lovely to see you here. I'm Sue Saxon, Education Manager in Kaldor Public Art Projects, and I'm really delighted to welcome you to the first of our very wide-ranging series of public programs celebrating Project 28, Roman Ondak, at the Parramatta Town Hall. Our esteemed presenter today, Rachel Kent, Chief Curator of the Museum of Contemporary Art, has been speaking with Roman Ondak in the past week, and she'll explore his practice and preoccupations, as well as the points of intersection with her own interest in the relationship of artist and audience and participatory art practices. Rachel joined the MCA in 2000, and that was when I had the pleasure of first working with her and encountering the passion and formidable expertise with which she curates, publishes and speaks on contemporary international and Australian art. She's presented exhibitions in Australia, New Zealand, Japan, the USA and Canada, and has curated the very engaging survey exhibition, War Is Over If You Want It, Yoko Ono, which is currently on show at the MCA and until 23rd February. So please join me in welcoming Rachel.
Hello and welcome. Thank you for coming. I'm very appreciative because it's such a hot day out there, so it's very nice to see you here, and I hope it's a cooler and calmer environment. I'm going to treat this as a very informal presentation. I have not scripted it, but what I did want to do is just give you some personal insights into the wonderful work of the Slovakian artist Roman Ondak. I've talked quite a lot with him in recent days, so I feel like I'm going to try and channel the spirit of Roman and also give you some of his words directly in response to the works that you have seen or you will see after this at the Parramatta Town Hall. As Sue mentioned also, I guess Roman's work falls within a wider line of inquiry that I find very interesting, and it's to do with art that is not necessarily institutional. Art that doesn't necessarily take the form of, say, a painting or a sculpture within a museum, but art which exists within the everyday, which is transformed or undergoes a process of change, which is affected by yourselves as audience, viewers, participants. And art, I suppose, that slips between this idea of the everyday and the museum. I think all of these ideas originated in their currency early in the 20th century. However, there are artists in particular who were working in, you know, the early to mid 1960s who come to my mind as being very influential in terms of this kind of creative practice that is, I guess, socially engaged, hands-on, participatory, and so forth. Sue mentioned my exhibition at the Museum of Contemporary Art at the moment, which is called War Is Over If You Want It, and it's a survey by the Japanese artist Yoko Ono. I don't know if anyone here has had a chance to see that. Oh, okay, a few people, good. But actually, I think there are some really interesting relationships or resonances between Yoko's work and the work that you see of Roman Ondak, which continues that tradition of social engagement, community participation, and so forth. I should also say that, you know, in the case of somebody like Yoko Ono, the idea itself forms the artwork. The object or the physical manifestation of that idea is certainly important, but in a way it's secondary, and I would suggest that in a way Roman's work is not so dissimilar, because his work too starts with an idea or an instruction, an invitation to participate, just like hers does, and from there it's like a row of dominoes. It's a catalyst really for thinking and for, I guess, getting a process of art making into movement. Now what I'd like to do also is just tell you a little bit about Roman Ondak's background, because I find it fascinating, and I'm not sure how familiar you are with his background. Do people know much about Roman, or have you seen his work before this? Yeah, I think some of you fortunately will have had the chance to see 13 Rooms, which was a fabulous Kaldor project. It was almost 12 months ago.
It was in April.
I have to say it was one of my favourite projects to see in Sydney, and it was a series of installations or environments which took the form of, I guess, frameworks for participatory and performative artworks, one of which was Roman's work called Swap. So some of you have participated in Swap before. You'll see it restaged here at the Parramatta Town Hall as part of his wider exhibition. I have to say I've been quite fortunate over time in that I've encountered various works of Roman's in different parts of the world, one of which is actually Measuring the Universe, which you can also see at the Parramatta Town Hall. I saw it, it was probably 5 years ago now when he staged it at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in New York. So my name and the date of my visit is under many layers of white paint now in MoMA. It's back up there in Parramatta. I'll bring my son next week and add him. And of course document it all for fun. And also I saw his work at the Venice Biennale, another wonderful work where he brought the outside indoors into the pavilion at the Biennale, but I'll show you an image of that. What I have got for you is a selection of images, not just of the works that are being shown at Parramatta, but also some wider context for understanding his work. And I said that I wanted to tell you a little about his background too, just to give you some wider context for where he's coming from and why he's making this kind of work that he's making, which is, I guess, not anti-institutional, but sits outside of the white walls in often, and I guess gets out to the streets, involves people in different kinds of ways. Now, Roman was born in 1966, and he was born in what was former Czechoslovakia, which, as many of you would know, is a country or region that has since undergone quite dramatic transformation. He grew up under communism, and in fact, he studied as a painter originally. It's hard to imagine when you look at this work, which is so conceptual and so kind of hands-off in terms of his own presence. And I think actually it's not so surprising, in fact, that he's here virtually, but he's not here in person to be here with us for the exhibition, because in a way he is a catalyst who sets the work up but then steps back and allows you to create it. So I guess it's not such a shame that he's not here, because, you know, he's set things up and now it's actually you who make the exhibition complete. That said, I do have his words, so I'm still going to channel his spirit and give you some of his thoughts. But as I said, so he grew up under a socialist state, and he studied painting in the late 1980s. And in fact, he had about a year and a half of studying painting under the socialist system in the former Czech Republic. And this was, I guess, an interesting time for him, because things were very closed, borders were closed, travel wasn't possible, you know, the economy of the country was quite slow, there wasn't a lot of money, but also importantly, there wasn't that much contact with the outside art world, and particularly with contemporary art. Now, often when we look at these kinds of socially engaged practices, practices that involve people and community, they come from a very different place. You know, they come from, I guess, you know, countries or regions where there is the capacity for a lot more interaction and flow, a lot more dialogue with other artists from other parts of the world. Roman's background didn't have that. It was a lot more closed. And so when the country underwent this major change, some of you may know there was a kind of a bloodless revolution or coup. It was called the Velvet Revolution in 1989. And this was the beginning of the transformation of what was former Czechoslovakia and the breaking apart of what would become Slovakia and then the Czech Republic. Now he's from Bratislava, which is the capital city in what is now Slovakia. I have to say, actually, if you look at a map, it is almost next to Vienna, so it's not geographically closed off, but those borders were quite rigid through the 80s and in fact right into the early 1990s. It was on the 1st of January in 1993 that Slovakia established itself as an independent federal state, and, you know, borders were open. There was this whole new possibility for travel, for engagement, for sharing ideas, but also geography, and for artists to get out and about and actually engage with other practices from other parts of Europe and also the wider world. Now, there was, of course, a very interesting and, I guess, relatively underground scene operating in Czechoslovakia, you know, when Roman was young. And he has talked about the fact that during the 1970s and 80s, you know, there were some very interesting, you know, political and socially aware artists who were working in his area, and those practices were quite inspirational for him. But it was with this opening up of the borders and this ability to communicate more widely that his practice in turn began to shift. And during the 1990s, he moved completely away from painting and started this much more open, socially oriented practice that involved other people. Now you'll see there are three works at Parramatta. Of course, there's Measuring the Universe, there's Swap, and there's a new work that Sue talked about called Terrace. Now, each of these works is uniquely personal, and I should say that a lot of Roman's work actually comes out of his life, his experiences, his family. In fact, some of the work in the exhibition is inspired by his children and measuring their growth on a doorframe, as we all do in our homes. But really the key themes that you'll see in the display are themes of relocation, and I mean the relocation from everyday life to the context of art. Transformation, by which I mean the transformation of ordinary objects or gestures, as well as spaces and physical architecture. And finally, disappearance, the idea of an artwork that exists for the period of its display only. You help make it. It has a set time frame, which is dependent on who comes to the exhibition, how many people come to the exhibition, and then, of course, the exhibition's conclusion, at which point the artwork is perhaps destroyed or it could be painted over. It ceases to exist until the next iteration of that same project, which could be in a different country, a different year, so the thread is picked up once again. When I spoke with Roman, he used the word loop a lot, this idea of a loop from the self outwards, in this case embracing the wider world all the way to Sydney, and looping back again to the self. So it's very much about the individual in relation to the community. And I find that really fascinating, because this idea of an art that is so open, so fluid, which changes every time it's presented, and which has really no end point, but is a constant process of transformation, I think is very reflective of everyday life, and it kind of invites you to look at things quite differently, to see the world in different ways, to understand that art isn't just one fixed thing, an object or a painting in a museum, but actually it's life and life's processes as well. And I guess transforming or adapting those processes in often subtle, even imperceptible ways. In fact, when you look at Terrace, if you were to take that work outside of the Parramatta Town Hall, you'd probably just walk past it because you'd think it's a terrace. It's actually a recreation of the little veranda or terrace up on the first floor of Roman's home. So actually he's changed the height, brought it downwards, and then brought it into an exhibiting space. So it's bringing the outside in, and also it's bringing his home to you. So again, even if he's not here in person, his home is here with you, which I really like. What I might talk about now is a couple of works in particular that will just give you a little context to understanding the exhibition at the Parramatta Town Hall. Has everyone had a chance to see the works yet? Okay, presumably you'll go back and see them afresh, I hope. Now, as I said, things shifted for Roman early in his artistic career when the Czechoslovakian borders opened up and the Slovakian, entity began to exist. This was around about when he was 22, 23. But borders opened and all of a sudden you could travel. But the interesting thing about this was that you had freedom on one hand, but on the other you had limitations, because travel of course is enabled by money, and under a socialist state, or even a former socialist state, there's not a lot of that. And so this tension between suddenly finding no borders, no restrictions, the ability to go where you might want to go, it's great in theory, but how does one do it in practical reality? For many people, even without those borders and restrictions, travel was still difficult financially. And I guess what that does is it exposes this, you know, gulf, quite a big economic gulf between East and Western Europe, or, you know, Eastern or Central Europe, where Roman is from, and Western Europe, which was at that time, and I think still continues to be, considerably more affluent. So this question of travel and place is actually very important within his practice. And I'll tell you a little bit about that in a moment. Now, the other thing that I want to point out is that I guess that shift from communism or socialism to a democratic state was very important for him in terms of shifting his career from painting and opening his ideas outwards, because he says, you know, I was aware at that time of what I was doing and I was losing perspective. And he talks about this idea of a void opening up. People think of possibility, walls coming down, possibility arising, but actually he talks about this idea of a giant void, you know, okay, where do I fit? What am I going to do? What's the relevance of my art? You know, who am I actually showing it to? And where do I show my art? You know, I don't have museum invitations. I don't have lots of galleries to show at. So he says, what he wanted to do was explore the potential of non-institutional, non-exhibition artworks by creating works from nothing. And he said, well, you can do something for nothing, or you can do things for your friends and your family. And they don't necessarily have to be concrete objects. They could be invisible gestures. They could even be instructions. So really, this is the point at which he started actually inviting other people in to effectively create the work for him. He'd set the conditions up for the creation of the work, but he'd then hand it over and almost step back and, in this case, allow his friends, his family members and so on to continue the chain of production and realize the artworks. And he says that he did this because he was influenced by my circumstances. He says, I stopped painting in the 90s and I followed a direction that would now be mine, which I think is really important. So in the second half of the 90s, he turned to these collaborations with his relatives to create what he calls a parallel world to the world of exhibitions or institutions, artworks that would in fact exist without necessarily being shown, as it were. And he says that his intention was not institutional critique as such, but actually he wanted to work outside of the context of art, and he wanted to create something that was close to realistic, but actually where people could read it as art, but without the pressure of deadlines, without the pressure of an institutional obligation or expectation, without the pressure of necessarily having to find a museum or a gallery to show in. After all, if you're making work for your friends and your family, why not get them involved to help make it? I guess this idea of relocating things from the context of life to the exhibition was, as he says, and I'll quote him here because I like this, he says it was an escape from painting, and it was an escape to sculpture, but without sculpting. It was about space, and the space in our mind, the space in the universe of our mind. So again, this whole idea of space, both physical space, but also mental space, which of course is infinite. You know, we may be constrained by our buildings or the lives or, you know, the towns that we occupy, but in our mind, there are no boundaries. We can basically create whatever it is we want to. And he says, I always try to go to the edge of my experience, not just to return to existing things. Now, there are a couple of early examples of this kind of work where he was bringing relatives and friends in. For example, he was invited to show in a gallery space at one point. And so what he did was he gathered friends and he described from memory the gallery space to 24 people and then invited each person to draw that gallery space based on his description. So everybody's drawing, of course, was quite different because his description was based on memory. It wasn't photographing or documenting the space. Theirs was an interpretation of his memory. So he had, I guess, a kind of double transformation in that process, and the drawings that came out of the process were all quite unique and different. So that's what he actually showed in the gallery itself. And again, this idea of a loop is important here because he says, I created a loop between myself, my community, his immediate community in Bratislava, and the room or the exhibition. Then there was another work, and that work I'm just showing you here. It's a work in 2000 and it's called Common Trip. Trip as in travel or voyage to a place. Now, this particular work, it refers to Roman's travels to different sites, to different architectures or spaces. Some of it could be in the same city, some of it could be elsewhere, some of it could just be a building down the road. But again, he described these experiences of travel to a range of people, and he invited them to make objects and drawings, which he showed together in one room. And as he said, it was almost like walking through his memory and community in Slovakia. So you can see, you know, there's an Eiffel Tower, there's various buildings and architectural structures, but you can also see interiors of spaces too. But again, it's other people's retelling of his stories or memories about travel. It's important to remember that he made this work in 2000. So, you know, it was some time after 1989, after borders were open. But as he says, it's not just about travel, but it's about isolation from the possibility of travel and also the inability for some people to travel due to these economic restrictions and the inability financially to take travel on and actually get out into the world. So you could almost look at this work, Common Trip, as a kind of collective imaginary. It's kind of imaginary trip around the world. I'll just talk a little bit about the personal and the familial in Roman's work as well. This is a work called Teaching to Walk from 2002. I didn't see it in Melbourne, but it was shown there a few years ago at ACCA, and I know, Sue, you might have seen it, and probably a few others have here.
Yeah, is that right? We spoke to the curators there, and it wasn't a solo show, it was a...
Part of a group presentation. Yeah.
It was very popular.
Yeah, it's a lovely work. I mean, this is a different aspect of Roman's practice because it involves what you might call interventions. It's not objects or drawings in a gallery. It's actually human presence. It's performers or actors or volunteers or perhaps family members who are invited to perform within the gallery space. But it's very subtle. You may not even notice that it's a plant, as it were. It's simply somebody coming in for a set duration every day over the course of the exhibition. And I think it was about 30 minutes a day where a mother would come in with her toddler and she would try and teach them to walk day after day after day. So there was this idea of, natural progression from, you know, I suppose over a period of, you know, a couple of months of an exhibition, a child who's perhaps crawling or stumbling or grasping to stand at the beginning of the exhibition, and then a child who's more mobile at the end. So it's very much about measurement, and it's about time and duration. So I think it has quite a lot of relevance to the work Measuring the Universe in Parramatta Town Hall, but I'll come back to that in a moment. It's also, of course, you know, a really subtle work, an intervention, as I said. Some people may not actually even notice or realise it is an artwork and that these are people who've been invited to come into the gallery to quietly perform. He's made a number of works like this over the years. That's actually Roman himself on the right. And he has young children himself. So again, thinking of that idea of the loop, a lot of these ideas actually loop back to himself, to his life, to his social environment, as well as his political environment. And I think also this idea of learning to walk at that time in the early 2000s is also about learning to walk as an artist, learning to engage more broadly, learning about contemporary art when one hasn't had access before, and kind of learning one's own path, you know, how you want to proceed as an artist through life. This is a work I really love. And this relates directly, again, to Measuring the Universe, one of the three works that you see in the Kaldor project at Parramatta Town Hall. All it is two photographs. It's called His Affair with Time, his being Roman's son, his young son. And what you see in the photographs is the hallway of Roman's house in Bratislava, which looks just like everybody else's. but, of course, you see on the door frame, there are notches, there are lines, and there are dates. And what they do, as with many of us with kids, is they mark incrementally the growth of his son as a toddler, gradually getting taller and taller every few months, every year. And it's funny, actually, when we spoke, we had a Skype conversation a few days ago, and one of the first things we did was we picked up our laptops, and I trotted over to my doorframe, and I turned the laptop around and aimed the camera and said, "Look at this," and showed him my doorframe, and he went over to his and did the exact same thing, and we laughed, because again, you know, a work like this is really about community and connections, and again, this idea of the loop from the personal to the community and back again. Here he was at, it would have been 6 p.m. in Bratislava, on the other side of the world showing me his draw frame with his child markings, and then me at, it was 7 a.m. in Sydney, showing mine, and it was almost exactly the same. So there you go. But I think this idea of time and the measurement of time is really central to Roman's practice. I mean, it's a simple thing, a thing like this, you know, measuring the growth of a child. It's something that's common to us all. So again, there is that loop between the individual and the community. But it's also about this question of how does one measure time, you know? And I'm talking about time from, you know, kind of ordinary daily level to, you know, deep time, you know, the time of our existence, you know, a life cycle, a human life cycle. How does one measure that and gauge it? And it's interesting too, because when you're a child, your concept of time is very, very different from when you're an adult. I'm sure anyone here who's tried to explain time to a young child will have found that quite a challenge. And it's something actually that I've thought about a lot in relation to my son, who's actually not much older than Roman's son, because he's asked questions about time and time's meaning and how to explain duration to him has actually made me really sit down and think over the last few years, because you've got the kind of immediacy of time. You know, you might have a child in the back of the car saying, when are we there? When are we there? And it's like 5 minutes. But then you've also got these questions that slowly arise as your child grows. How long am I going to live? Are you going to die before me? When is the weekend? You know, what day is it today, the first or the second day of the weekend? All of those questions, from, you know, the big philosophical questions to the really practical understanding of daily time and its passage. And of course, a small child will understand 5 minutes, you know, because you can say, okay. And in fact, these photographs are taken at roughly 5 minutes apart. So it's the same image, but a 5 minute gap between them. And sure, you could say, oh, well, 5 minutes ago, you ate that apple and I took that photograph. Now, 5 minutes has passed, you've eaten the apple and I've taken the second photograph. Well, that's understandable, but to explain the passage of time that's articulated on that door frame over years, months and years, is a whole lot harder for that child to grasp, because that's a much bigger sense of time. And that really leads me, I'll skip that one for now, that really leads me to this work, which is called Measuring the Universe. Like I said, he starts with the personal that always fans out to the wider political, to the community, to all of us together. And I think this idea of the universe or the universal is part of that quest. Measuring the Universe is a work that Roman has presented at the Museum of Modern Art in 2009. He's also showed it in the UK. And you will see it at Parramatta Town Hall, and I hope you've all been in and marked yourselves onto the walls. You have to go back if you haven't. But it's essentially a communal drawing, and it's about this mapping of time and duration in this case, rather than the growth of a child from, you know, maybe 2 or 3 up to 8 or 10 or 15. It's a measurement of time from the beginning to the end of the exhibition's duration. And of course, at the end of that, white paint goes onto that wall and the work ceases to be. But essentially every person coming into the gallery has their height measured, and the date at which their height has been measured is marked onto the wall. So essentially it's almost like a diary or a charting of the exhibition from day one right through to the final day. And then it gets painted over. But then, of course, the line is not broken, the loop is not broken, because the work may reappear again in a different place a year or two later in a different part of the world, and that thread is picked up again. So it's an interesting work because it's migratory. It's something that you can restage over and over at different times, at different places. So essentially, it's a work with no end. Think about that in relation to, say, a painting or a sculpture in a museum. It's a very, very different proposition. And in some ways, I find it a lot more interesting. I guess it's a more of a philosophical proposition. Just show you some other images. This is from the MoMA iteration of the work. The other thing I love about it is that, you know, as the days pass, the lines build up, and eventually it becomes almost like this kind of babble or this really dense soundtrack of human activity. and I guess the growth of a community. You could also talk about this work as being something of a portrait, and the idea of portraiture in Roman's work I think is also really interesting. You may have a portrait through a measurement of his child, just as you may have a portrait of an individual within this wall, but then you also have a portrait of a wider community, a kind of universe of people. So again, you've got this play between the individual and the communal, between the micro, the macro, perhaps, you know, between your solitary individual experience and that of the wider universe. So I think this idea of measuring the universe, the title of the work, is very apt in many ways. And everybody gets into it as well, which I really like. Okay. That brings me to the work swap. Now, I won't talk forever because I know you want to go back and start measuring. So I skipped a few works. But swap is another really great work, I think. It's similar to measuring the universe in its formal aspects. For example, both involve some kind of white room. In the case of measuring the universe, you also have a volunteer of some kind or a staff member and a felt tip pen. In the case of swap, you have a performer, a table, and a chair. Now, I mentioned portraiture before because, interestingly, this particular work, the performers who sit at the table and the chair are only men. I don't know if anyone's noticed that. And when Roman pointed this out, I said, why? Why are there no women? Why can't I do it? And he said, no, because it's me. And actually, this idea of a kind of displaced self, and a kind of personalized portrait is really important in his work. As I said, it always starts with the individual and fans outwards. So effectively, all of the performers you see in this work are kind of stand-ins for Roman himself, and they're having a conversation on his behalf with you. So again, it's a loop that goes outwards from him to somebody else, to a community, and loops back again. Like measuring the universe, it has a set duration. It's just from the beginning to the end of the exhibition, and it's very light on its feet, like measuring the universe. It doesn't leave any residue or any detritus. Nothing is wasted. As with the first work, a wall is simply painted over and the work ceases to be until its next iteration. In this case, the performers fulfill their duty and go home. The table and the chair just gets repurposed again. So again, it's really light on materials, light on its feet. So it's, again, very different from painting or sculpture in a museum. One of the things that I guess is central to this work is this idea of exchange, or a chain of exchange, but it's limited by the conditions of the exhibition. So it's limited by the space of the gallery or town hall, by the duration of the exhibition, from the first performer and object right through to the last one, but it's also unpredictable. And I think this idea of chance, of the unpredictable, is really important too in terms of Roman's work, because you can't predict the outcome of this series of exchanges. Again, he sets the conditions up for the work, but then he steps back, he puts a kind of doppelganger, if you like, in the seat in place of himself, and they start with something, but who knows who will come into the exhibition, what they're going to bring, what kind of exchange will take place. And it's an interesting work too, because it's about value, what value we place on objects in our lives. Because some people come prepared, they've heard about the work, or maybe they're coming back a second or third time, so they find a significant object that they're willing to give up. But a lot of the time you arrive randomly, you don't know what the work is, and so you're kind of rifling through your wallet thinking, oh, what do I not mind handing over because I'm not going to get it back? So, you know, you can hand over a bus ticket, but is that worth a symbolic exchange or not? I mean, maybe it is. But actually, I've already seen today people have brought in really quite special things, but you have to be willing to let go of your possessions, hand them over, and allow them to go into the next person's hand. So that is the condition for the artwork and your role or participation within it. I saw someone brought in a beautiful metal key earlier, and I was eyeing the key thinking, I really like that key. And I don't think I had anything that I felt was valuable enough, I don't know, aesthetic, materially, financially perhaps, to exchange for that key. And then somebody else came in with their child, and their child had brought a drawing. And now that was special. And, you know, you're not going to exchange a postage stamp for this child's drawing, because, again, that drawing's personal and it's precious. So You know, you kind of have to think about your role and what it is that you're willing to give up, but also what you give meaning and value to within your life. I like that a lot. The other challenge, of course, is that these performers, or these kind of romans in disguise, have really interesting conversations. They talk about the objects, they ask you about the meaning of the objects, and they create a narrative framework around which the work unfolds and people come forward and they give their objects. Sometimes it can be a bit of a scrum. If something good goes onto the table, everyone gets excited. And again, the idea of value gets ramped up and people start searching for something better that they know they're going to be able to exchange to get that good thing off the table. I've been thinking all day about the things that I can take in. I've got a few treats. The other thing I like about these works is that they're very egalitarian. It doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what knowledge you may or may not have about art. You need a degree in art history to be involved in these works, but you can also be a child. So they're very, very open and fluid. The final thing I'll talk about is Terrace. So I just want to talk about some of his architectural interventions or constructions. Of which he's made a number over time. And he is interested in making these interventions into physical space, things that are sometimes quite subtle. You may not even notice them. You may walk straight past. For example, if you were to take Terrace out of the Parramatta Town Hall and put it onto a shop front somewhere else in Church Street, you'd probably walk past it. You wouldn't realise that it is an artwork. But this is a nice example I thought I'd just show you first. It's called Loop, and again, it's coming back to that idea of the individual fanning outwards to the community and looping back again, or kind of telling this kind of thread of narrative that goes from the personal outwards and back. It's actually the work that Roman made for the Czech and Slovak Republics in 2009 for the Venice Biennale. It says 2004. It's 2009 because I remember seeing it only a few years ago. But you can see kind of clearly what it is he's up to in this case. One of the themes that he talks about in terms of his more architectural works or spatial interventions is this idea of inside and outside, the idea of mirroring, reflecting, looking inwards and outwards, but also inverting indoors and outdoors. So, you know, when he was invited to make this work for the Venice Biennale, which is, you know, a big deal for any artist, instead of rushing off to the studio and creating objects, as many artists would do, he actually thought about the space surrounding the pavilion. At the Venice Biennale, you have this area called the Giardini, and it's these beautiful gardens within which you have these national pavilions, and, you know, an artist or artists from each country get invited to show their work within the pavilion. So when he started thinking about this idea of, I guess, national representation, the idea of these national pavilions or structures that people come from the Giardini into and then out from, he decided rather than actually put objects into the pavilion, he would simply bring nature in and kind of extend what was outside. And it's nice because you can see through the door frame and what you see outside is virtually exactly the same as what you see inside. But it had this really quite disorienting feel. Did anybody else see this? No, okay. It was quite funny because I, like many people, wandered in without a brochure, without prior knowledge, and sort of walked in and went, oh, hang on a second. I thought I was going in somewhere. I feel like I'm outside. Hang on. Looks just like what I saw outside. And it does, this kind of subtle shift of the way you perceive space, what your expectations of that space are, also what your expectations of art are. Because again, you know, you're going into a national pavilion, you're expecting, you know, an artist to perhaps make something that's grandiose or some kind of big statement because it's their national statement. Yet all he did was bring the outside in and swap things around. And which I thought was much more subtle and interesting. And if you think about Terrace, he's done a very similar thing. This is the Parramatta Town Hall. I just wanted to show you a few pictures. You can see it out on the street, but I really like it as a building. And he's completely transformed this space too in his exhibition. This image in particular I like, and Sue and I just chatted at length about it earlier because we sat down and looked at, okay, this is where the exhibition is when you come in, but you totally wouldn't recognize it. Now, you come into the door on the left-hand side, And you can see there's another door just past it, and it's the space between those two doors outside on the left where Terrace is shown. So when you enter the building, you see Terrace as though you're standing outside it. Then you can loop through the door and see it as though you're standing inside, effectively in Roman's apartment, because it's his terrace. And it looks exactly like his terrace looks in real life, because here's his terrace. But as you can see, it's in Bratislava, not Western Sydney, and it's up a level. It's raised up onto the first floor. But I think this idea of transposition, of taking kind of ordinary details, adding to them, shifting them slightly, embellishing or manipulating them in often quite subtle ways, is very central to his practice. Just for your interest, we worked out on the right-hand side is where you would have swap, just over here, and then you would have measuring the universe in the second part of the town hall space, and you would have seen there's an open door with a sort of barrier across it, which is that door just there on the right, which, as Sue said, is now painted white. So it's kind of complete transformation of that space. So going back to Roman's balcony and this idea of indoors and outdoors, interior, exterior, the idea of a private home and then a kind of public art statement, a lot of these things he's been working through in his recent practice. And I'm going to end the talk just by showing you one of his most recent works, which is a work that he's made for the Reina Sofia Museum in Madrid. I don't know if anyone's seen this work. Is anyone familiar? It's a work called Literally Seen, and of course, you know, as with Measuring the Universe, it involves a kind of play on words or a kind of duality in terms of the words chosen. I mean, it's a scene, as in, you know, a scene of a place. It's also about seeing and looking, and again, this idea of inside and outside, or in this case, transparent glass walls that you can look into or out from. This is actually an existing glass house. It's from about 1887, and it's in the park just near the Reina Sofia Museum. And you know what? Can you see what he's done? All he's done is actually build a kind of pathway around it. Basically, people would only really see the work from outside and upwards a level originally. So all he's done is actually build this little raised brick pathway with a handrail wrapping all the way around it, so people can kind of go up to it and they can walk around the perimeter and go look inwards, and then they can go inside and look outwards. So it's a very similar principle to Terrace, obviously on a much bigger scale, and it's outdoors in a public space, in a park rather than within a town hall. But the principle is the same, this idea of looking inwards and outwards, taking a space that's very specific to one history, one place, and transposing it. So there you go, and there's also a mirror and some reflection as well. Yep. I'll leave it on there. I guess the last thing I'll say, just to conclude in terms of Terrace, which I think is a lovely work, again, it's not a work I think that, I mean, you'll destroy that work at the end, right?
Yeah.
So it's not a work like the other works in Roman's exhibition that lives on in perpetuity. It's taken down, it's destroyed at the end of this exhibition, but of course it will be reconstructed in a different place at a different time, and it will probably have quite a different meaning. Now, he always says that these works, even though they're inspired by the personal, and you know, it is a facsimile of his Terrace, it's not about him and his personal life at home. It's just taking, I guess, the beginning point of a loop and extending it outwards to the wider community and linking it back again. He also talks about the idea of the terrace as being an in-between space, the idea of, you know, it's not interior or exterior. It's, you know, the space from which you descend and observe street life, kind of like a balcony. But also, it's an iconic image in the history of art as a symbolic space. For example, you can see, you know, there's a very famous representation of a terrace in the painting of Manet. So it's basically a kind of dual space. It's a space to observe, but also to be observed from, which is very much like this glass house here. And I think that's a nice way to end the talk, because this idea of looking outwards and then staring back in, starting with the personal but fanning outwards to the political and the wider universal, I think is really at the crux of Roman's work. And I think it's an extraordinary practice, quiet, subtle, often people may not, even necessarily notice so much what it is. But once you sit down and think about it and what it's trying to do, how it's transforming space, how it's transforming ideas, I think it has a wonderful impact. So I'll leave the talk there. But I wonder if you have any questions. We probably have just a few minutes.